log out is the hardest button to press. That's the reality of life today. Over the last few weeks, unless you've been living under a rock, you would have heard of the Blue Whale Challenge. It is said to be an online game in which a designated curator assigns players various tasks over a 50-day period, culminating in the player committing suicide. It is believed to have originated in Russia. Several suicides across India have been linked with the challenge in some form or the other, though as of now, there's no clear-cut proof of a connection. Still, the alarm bells have gone off as smartphones burrow their way into our lives further and further, becoming an additional limb. Is there a new social and health crisis in India? A modern epidemic of internet addiction, especially amongst children. Priyanka Bansal and Vinita Bansal are the aunt and the mother of a class 1 student. They believe that their niece actually downloaded this Blue Whale game or app or something like that on one of the family phones. If she's in class 1, she's what, 7 years old?
She's 7.
How did this happen?
She suddenly asked me, "Bua, what is Blue Whale game?" So I refused, you know, inside I refused to hear that Blue Whale game. I said, "Blue Whale?" She said, no, Blue Whale game. And my niece is a very brave and very chirpy girl, but the time she was asking this, she was a little nervous. So I got scared. Mujhe laga shayad she started playing or something like that. So I said, "Wo to bhoot ka game hai, you should not play it. Why are you even asking about it? Wo bhoot ka hai." So she started screaming.
Classic Indian parenting.
Indian, yes. So I thought ki I should say that to keep her off. Then we started asking her that who told you about this game. She said, "There are two boys in my van. They are bhaiya, my seniors." So she said, "These bhaiya have told me to download this game." So I asked in which class are they. She said, 4th and 5th. This I deleted it anyways. But then when I went to sleep, it was not letting me, like the thought was not letting me sleep. And my training is in such a way that we cannot keep things to us.
So you're
then,
a journalist.
Yeah.
So which is why you felt the need to speak
out.
Yeah.
So I thought, yeah, I should not keep it to me only. I should put it in some platform so that others should also get to know about this game or
and you
challenge.
Wrote a Facebook post that has
right.
gone viral, which is
then
how we
I
also
thought,
found out about
right,
it.
Right.
But
right.
I want to check, you know, in your post, there was something that stood out. You say that your niece is comfortable in using Android Play Store
right.
and usually downloads baby games and play. And you say that we take it lightly and we let her use our phones.
Right, right.
So the moms also, you're Vinita, you're the mother, right? So we are all guilty.
Right,
but
right,
the point
exactly.
is, it sounds like at some level, you're proud of your niece, right? Because she's so young and she can navigate technology and she can do it so well. And a lot of us get confused when unable to do that.
Look, it is necessary for the kids to be friendly with the gadgets. Otherwise, if they don't do that, they will stand out of the society.
Okay.
Today is a technical world. We can't stop them touching the phones. But when that friendly mobile of her papa became monster, we didn't came to realize. It's just a thin line between friendly and dangerous.
You say you brought it up, took it up with the school authorities?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What happened?
They are very friendly. They are very supportive. They all took counseling session in the school. But it's not school's responsibility. It's my responsibility, being a parent.
But it was very important to inform school. So within 15 minutes, we called up the principal. She was very much, you know, she came into action and she said, "First thing in the morning, what I'm going to do is I'm going to call the parents of those two, three boys."
What did those parents say?
They were like, "Ki, my son cannot do that and he don't know my phone password." So she just refused it. I don't know what is going on behind her psyche. Yeah.
So we have two sets of parents here. One
right.
parent who is taking responsibility.
Right. She's accepting at least.
They are responsible. And there's another set you're saying is not clear. Natasha Badwar is a well-known author. She has the famed parenting column on Mint. She is a communication expert. She's the author of the book My Daughter's Mom. In a different life, she was also one of NDTV's first women camera person. She joins us now, Natasha. Now, these, if you hear the story, it sounds like these are compulsions of working parents today, right? That's the life we live. Nuclear families, both parents are working, and the phone is the babysitter today.
So one of the things we need to acknowledge is that the phone is also the parents' toy. You know, we're mesmerized. We're mesmerized by our smartphones. Most of us, most parents were already adults when their first smartphone came into their life. And we are so much in awe of this amazing thing, you know, that takes selfies, that networks us with all kinds of people, that brings in these notifications, that makes us feel that we exist in a wider world, that we forget what it can mean for children. Children are not exposed to everything that adults are exposed to, yeah, children don't go out of the house alone. Children do not watch certain kinds of media content. We show them certain things. We hold their hand when they're walking, you know, crossing the road, etc. The world is an unsafe place. And so now is the internet. So now are, you know, all this gamut of video games that children can be exposed to. And we need to create a new etiquette. You know, we need to realize that this personal awe that we have is something that we need to also dissect. We need to also break it down and see when is it okay to hand them over to children. You know, this huge excuse that we are working parents, well, how do we keep them occupied? People kept their children occupied before smartphones came in, you know, right. Before we had 24/7 TV, before we had full-time nannies who were sitting on TV and feeding
them.
You're
saying it's an excuse and parents need to own up and be harder and truer to themselves. But look, we're all guilty, right? We may be in a public space, you're on a plane, you're in a restaurant, the kid's acting up and you're just like, oh God, just give her the phone. If you're a conscientious parent, then you want the child to quieten down. So you're damned if you do, damned if you don't.
You wouldn't give a morphine injection to the child to quieten her down. There are limits to what you will do. You will give her a chocolate and say, okay, if this is what you want, if it's pizza that you want. So, yeah, sure, as parents, there are huge compulsions. There, you know, we look at short-term solutions. But we also, it's our responsibility, the child is not going to do that. But we also look at the overarching, you know, future goals.
So that's a short-term solution. Yes. It's certainly not a solution for the long term. It creates more problems. But a morphine injection, I don't know if we'll go that far. Pranesh Prakash is an affiliated fellow with the Yale Law School's Information Society Project. Pranesh, now we've seen all these cases of so-called blue whale cases and the press is going crazy about it. But somehow things don't seem to match up. There are a lot of loopholes. So are we blowing something out of proportion? What exactly do you think the problem is here then?
It's a case of blowing nothing out of proportion on the one hand, and the something that actually exists, completely ignoring it. What we should be focusing on is children, their mental health, bullying at school, incidents such as that which happened where older kids are telling younger kids to do certain kinds of things. And we never, for instance, talk about depression and that it's an actual mental health issue.
You're saying this is not a blue whale issue, this is not a technology issue, this is actually about a problem we have with mental health.
What I'm saying is, so for instance, the blue whale VR game, right? The top hit with more than 1 million downloads on the Google Play Store. Is this game about the actual animal, the blue whale, the world's largest mammal, etc., and you can wear VR glasses to you know, look at this. On the other hand, this, you know, what you read out as the intro, right, about this challenge or this game that supposedly takes place over 50 days, ends up with, you know, and one of the challenges is supposed to be the child or the person carving a blue whale on their arm, and the last challenge is supposed to be them committing suicide. That is completely fictitious. There is no evidence.
So then why have these cases of children committing suicide, what do you think is behind that? Is it mental?
There can be a variety of issues. In India, for instance, children have committed suicide because they've done badly in an exam. In Kerala, just a few weeks ago, a teen reportedly committed suicide after he was tortured by the police, and 2 days later he was found dead. So there are a variety of reasons why people take their own lives. We should focus on those rather than focusing on this non-existent mythical media creation called the Blue Whale Challenge.
Dr. Mahesh Sharma is the additional professor at Vimhans. Doctor, would you like to come in here?
If I would go into the gaming aspect or online gaming, what we are frequently seeing in our clinic also in the more teenager age group, we are seeing a bi-directional relationship between game and the psychological
problem. Wait a minute, you said your clinic. I just want to clarify, you set up the first de-addiction center in India.
India, that's Nimhans, our parent organization. The clinic name is Shut Clinic, that service for healthy use
when
of...
When did you set it up and why do you think there's a need for this?
It was set up in 2014 and I have been working in this area from 2008 onwards. And we did a lot of community surveys across various age groups. And across all the surveys, what we have found that there is a addictive use of technology. They have underlying psychological distress. Sometimes they do reports like commonly we have found free time, boredom, loneliness, and the inability to manage stress. these four variables which we have found commonly across most of the excessive users, and they do attribute because they are free, because there is nothing much to do and they like to spend time on the game or any online activities.
So, how many cases do you see? How serious is this really, doctor? One study says that 11% of India's cell phone and internet users are suffering from internet addiction. Is that really serious? Is the media blowing this out of proportion as we're often accused of doing?
What I can suggest, like when we started the clinic, we used to get one or two cases per week. So, now the frequency has come down to 5 to 6 cases per week. The empirical evidence which we have from Bangalore region, we have found almost 5 to 7% of the users have excessive to problematic to addictive use of technology.
How do you get away from something that is so pervasive in our lives today? What is the solution? You can't tell kids to stay off. We had a parent here saying that, aren't you disadvantaging your kid if you keep them away from mobiles and screens? Dr. Deepak Raheja, you're a psychiatrist. How do you stay away from something that's so all pervasive?
If I was to draw an analogy, I think of something like, let's say, food addiction. So you can't tell somebody to abstain from food, you know, so you'll have to work it around with moderation. It's very evident that when someone is addicted to technology and our lives are going to revolve around technology, it would be very difficult to say stay away, because, you know, it's like disadvantaging a kid because you're exposing the kid much later. Like, she used a very extreme example of saying you won't expose the child to morphine, but let's understand that how a smartphone would work, or how a social site would work, or how a child who's exposed to sexualizing or, you know, sex chatting would work will be something similar to how certain neurochemicals in the brain play, and that's very similar to how we deal with other addiction, you know. Now, out of this, there are going to be certain vulnerable few who will have a diathesis, who once exposed to that will not be able to stop, you know. And as the number of people who are being exposed to technology is increasing, the number of people who will channel out to have those diatheses will also increase. So it's very important that we identify them, we have the right mechanism. In schools, at homes, the parents are sensitized, the teachers are sensitized, so we are perceptive, you know. And something like Blue Whale, let's say, is not totally imaginary, because there are sites, there are games, there is technology like that available on internet. And Priyanka is very fortunate that her niece came and spoke to her, you know. I mean, if this was a vulnerable few, I mean, how the child is inculcated into that cult. I mean, as you read it, they're advised to wake up every day at 4:20 a.m. So it can't be 4:21, it has to be 4:20. Mm. They go through a certain set of exercises. Once inducted, they can't back out. So it's like a cult playing, you know. You're kind of trapped and hypnotized, and the child, with very little mechanism, very little support, with certain diatheses. So this may be a child who has certain other vulnerability factors.
Correct.
Maybe a discord at home.
You said there's a vulnerable few, right? My question is, we've said that it's not easily accessible. It means a child actually has to actively seek it out. So why would a child do that?
See, so again, you know, when we look at problematic internet use, if we try and draw a parallel, there are children who are going to be more, have a predilection towards gaming. There are kids who may start showing a predilection towards gambling. There are kids who may, or young adults who may start showing a predilection towards sex chatting. So these are various areas. But it's a virtual world, and in that virtual world, your ability to harness and work on your own skills, your own intra-psychic apparatus, becomes highly challenged. It becomes highly, highly demuned, you know. So with minuscule coping skills as you grow up, so you're dependent more on virtual world. Mm. There is withdrawal, there is tolerance, there's increased usage. You want to upgrade the software, you want to increase the number of hours that you spend. So the child is cocooned and withdrawn more and more. And by the time you realize that the effects have come on the personality, sometimes it's late.
Some of these are extreme, right? We do know that there are digital technologies that allow educational developmental benefits for kids. So as Vinita points out here, how do you draw the line then?
So again, you can't say no to technology. What I'm strongly advocating is that we need to be perceptive. It has to be timed, it has to be primed. You need to monitor the child, and this is not prying, you know. You could have a candid discussion with the child, and it's important to communicate with the child that why the internet must go off at a particular time, why it's important to prime the child that it might be all right to have a common computer in a public area, in a house where, you know, people pass by, the family members pass by, and they are perceptive to how the child is using it. So this is like a vulnerable child who is got limited coping skills, he's growing up. It is all right to monitor it. Please don't look at it as a privacy issue, you know. Talk and communicate with your child. Let's not look at it as a bane, you know. Let's look at it as a boon, with something that we need to monitor and help children use responsibly.
So talk to your kids more, right? And the doctor here is saying that you can't go cold turkey, or you shouldn't go cold turkey. We know somebody who actually has. Khushbu Sundar joins us. She's been a strong voice on Twitter. She speaks out. She's one of those women that just cannot be drowned out. But Khushbu, you are no longer on Twitter. Why is that? And this is a personal choice.
I think it was very important for me to quit because it was kind of an addiction. I've been listening to all the other people on the panel speaking about how any social platform is an addiction. And I completely agree with them, because for me, you know, I have to be the right example for my children. Two growing up daughters, who is 17 plus, the other one is 14 plus. So for me to tell them, don't do this, I should be the best example to them. Twitter was important to me because I need to stay connected with the people, also being into political field. But then I did find that it was addictive. You wake up in the morning and the first thing your hand goes to the mobile phone to check what are the tweets, what is happening. You need to give your statement. You need to be connected. You feel that you are connected with the world. Your opinion matters a lot. So all these things were there. And then I found myself, whether it was a dinner table with the family or an outing with the family or in the theater in between the in between or during the interval time, all you're doing is on your Twitter. In between my shots, I'm on Twitter. So I think, you know, that I realized that it was an addiction and I had to come out of it. And overnight I decided, no, I need to put a full stop to it. Because when I would tell my kids not to use their phones on the dining table, they would turn around and say, Amma, you're doing the same thing. So I said, yes, I am doing the same thing. So I need to be the best example. So I quit. And it wasn't difficult. Yes, sir, the temptations remain with so many happenings in the world, in our country, correct, that you need to react, you need to speak. But then I choose not to come back to Twitter because I feel that I don't want to get back into that addiction. There are far more different ways where I can connect with the people.
It's interesting you say that, because I would ask, don't you feel socially isolated, Khushbu? And, you know, FOMO, don't you have FOMO? You're a mother of two teenage kids. What if they say to you, but mom, all our friends are on chat lines and they're chatting, then what's the use of me going out to the playground if there is no other kid to play with?
No, I think that's where you need to have... I wouldn't say control, but understanding with your child, because when you explain it to them, they should understand as to why Amma or Appa are saying this. So even when their father spoke to them, because my husband is not on any social network, he's an alien to social network, everything is Latin and Greek to him. He's on WhatsApp because we forced him, so that when we travel abroad, it's easier to stay connected. Otherwise, he wasn't even on WhatsApp. So, you know, it's the understanding with the child you have, the kind of dialogue you have with the child. And you can't monitor a kid going into their mobile and trying to check as to what kind of a conversation they're having with their friends. It's just that you need to build the trust between your child and the parent. The child needs to trust the parent. There's any kind of distress, there's any kind of pressure, there's any kind of, a kind of peer pressure that, okay, this is there, my friends are there, and I need to do it. Yes, I of course go through it being teenagers. They have their rebel time where they say, no, my friends do it, so why can't I do it? But then I think you need to understand your child and you need to explain it to them. If you're going to be over strict with them, you tell them that don't do it, then they are bound to do it without your knowledge. They are going to hide it, do it behind the doors. So I think you need to have a very open door conversation. Tell them that we are here to guide them. And there are times when I tell them, you want to do something, go ahead, do it. And if you're going to hurt, I'm always there to look after you. You want to try it out, go ahead. So I think that's kind of a relationship you definitely need to build with your child in today's world.
Okay, but I have a practical question. You're a professional, you're a working woman, you're a politician. Doesn't this disadvantage you?
Yes, it is. It is a huge disadvantage to me. And like I said before, the temptations are there to come back to Twitter with 1 million followers. You feel that, okay, your voice is heard. And, you know, people from different political parties also keep coming and telling me, my friends from the media keep telling me, you should be back on Twitter. But I said, no, not now. I need time. I think I'm enjoying the time with my children. My duties as a politician will continue because I feel, you know, world over, we have not built every political party on a Twitter or a Facebook. These platforms have come in today. We have seen great leaders world over building their political careers or their parties without any of these social platforms. It's just that I feel whether it was any social network, you know, there was a lot of negativity, and you need to keep negativity at complete bay. Most of the people on these platforms, they are more into, it's not about what they react, it's just that there's unemployment at its peak where they are there only to criticize you, to meme and all that. So I thought you need to keep negativity at bay, and which was very important for me to keep my sanity intact.
All right, you wanted to keep your sanity intact. It all got too much. Karishma Attari is another woman who feels the same way. You're an author, you're a journalist, but what you're not is a WhatsApp mom. You, yes, it seems, took yourself off the WhatsApp groups of your kids at your kids' schools.
I have to start by saying my kids are 12, 11 and 8, and I have a joke with them, a running joke, that you can play on the iPad for 15 minutes a day so that when, you know, our artificial intelligence takes over, at least you can do menial tasks. You know, you'll be of some use in the future. I just feel like the internet has, it's like this big social experiment, right, since 1991, boom. And we've, as humans, evolved over millennia. And we're all first generation users. Now my kids are second generation users. And we're out of control, you know. Is technology working for us, or are we working for technology? As an experiment, I tried being on the WhatsApp groups related to my kids' schools. And I found that it's the last thing I do before I switch off my phone, even if it's 2 a.m. It's the first thing I see as soon as I wake up in the morning. And the level of discourse comes down to, you know, really important stuff like, do we have to stick or file this paper? So it's not just that a whole generation of women that are mothers, who are, I hope, thinkers, and most of them are pretty well educated.
And they working.
Working, homemakers, whatever your capacity, you're reduced to the lowest common version of yourself. And that's what I really object to, because literally we're typing out three words and we hit send. We don't even wait to complete a sentence. We don't use punctuation. We don't use full spellings. We don't even think. We're allowed to ask the dumbest, most random questions. And I object not just at the level of the parents, and it's always moms. How many fathers have downloaded apps and are on WhatsApp? Like in a decade of parenting, I haven't seen one. It's always the mothers, and there's this kind of social glare. Everyone is the good mom. Are you going to not be a super mom on WhatsApp? If you're there, you better be saying Happy Diwali. You better be saying Merry Christmas. You better be saying, oh, poor Deesh, is he okay? It's just levels.
Let's quickly check with the audience. Any fathers here who are on a WhatsApp group or their kids'
parenting
WhatsApp
group?
Well, not fair, because we don't know how many parents are here. What about moms? Any moms here? Okay, you're on your WhatsApp group. No, but Karishma, doesn't it affect your kids?
Yes. So the
and don't you feel, in a sense, I mean, I'm going to be blunt and crude, mm-hmm. right? It just looks like as if, you know, you don't care.
Oh,
all these moms are caring more about their kids and making sure that whatever sellotape and that file and that textbook and all of that in years, Karishma.
They're going to be, you know, pushing.
You know, she's absolutely right. It's the lowest level of yourself.
I think
it's the lowest version of yourself.
It's also killing children's sense of responsibility. What about they are, and it's a very regressive shift when you take accountability and responsibility away from kids and you put it on moms, you're creating helicopter parenting. It's very convenient for schools, but children are sort of not learning to be responsible for themselves, and that's a dreadful thing we're doing to this generation.
Wow, it's very convenient for schools. It's convenient that we have a principal here, Anju Puri. Respond to that.
It all depends from school to school. As a person, as a principal, even I don't encourage anything which is made by the parents in the homework to be given full marks. If we encourage, if suppose the child has done the work out of his own curiosity, out of his own creativity, then only we encourage. And that,
so this is the majority of schools have these WhatsApp groups,
but
right,
then for the there parents. Are so many schools who are doing it, and I do agree that yes.
And the schools condone it, they encourage the parents, they set it up, right? You put out the numbers, they allow them to set it up.
Yes, yes, they allow them to set up the group also, because it becomes convenient for a teacher to send the message. Just for own convenience, we are harming so many children. And so many parents are also being traumatized, and then they have to be there on the WhatsApp group only, otherwise they will not be able to access that. And then I would say that it's actually, we can't do away with the rule of the school. I was really happy the way Priyanka handled, though of course it may be not the genuine blue whale game, but it's happened that issue has been highlighted. And I'll tell you that there can be many dreadful games on the net to which they are addicted. Much smaller issues. And when I address the parents, I realize that it's not that all of them are enlightened about it. Then it becomes our role to make them aware of. The young years, if suppose you expose the child to these gadgets, their physical development is hampered, because if you see your child is glued to mobile all the time or to the laptop or the desktop, there is no physical exercise. And what we find is, because atmosphere outside is so scary, that parents are not sending the children to even parks, etc. for play.
Correct.
Now, in present scenario, it so happens that when the children stand out for morning assembly, as a school principals, even we have to have a nurse standing outside in the ground, stretchers and wheelchairs there, because if the assembly is extended from 15 minutes to 20 minutes, there will be 20 kids who will be falling down.
My God,
right. Somehow they feel that we are not hungry, we are not going to have any breakfast. These things also, basically they make the body weak. And I'm amazed how when they grow up, they'll be able to handle the future of the nation when we say that.
Right.
Okay, you allow your child to use the device, but only for a short duration of time. Beyond that, what you do is that you make certain rules that on the dining table, no mobile phone. Before sleeping, at least 1 hour before that, nobody should use such devices. There are medical reports which can even interfere with production of melatonin, and they'll not be able to sleep comfortably. Then sleep disasters will be there, and in the morning when they'll not be able to get up, you'll have to rush the child to the school without doing daily chores also.
Correct.
So this is what I feel, that parents have to take the onus also. School also has to take onus. I have been addressing the parents, and what I found is 50% parents are not even aware of what is firewall. Like when they have to use the gadgets at home, they should be aware of the softwares which are available by which they can block the sites which child should not see. So that awareness.
50% of parents are not even aware. Let's get Karnika Seth. She is a Supreme Court lawyer. She is a cyber and IP expert, the author of Protection of Children on the Internet. She trains enforcement on cyber laws and recommends policy and legal changes to government authorities to strengthen cyber law in the country. Are we even equipped to take this on, right? I mean, we're hearing so much in the media about this blue whale challenge and suicides. And then at the same time, you're hearing statements from our government and the ministry saying, ban it. How can you ban something that's not even a game or a WhatsApp group? I mean, are we even in a position where trying to control our kids who know more about this stuff than we do ourselves?
Correct. I completely agree. The cyber awareness as we need is a need of the hour, and not only for children. Children obviously need to be made aware of the dangers on the internet, but equally so, or probably even more, the parents and the schools, the academic faculties who really in touch with them day in and day out. And so is the need for judiciary, the judicial officers who are prosecuting these, you know, hearing these cases, and if they are reported in the first place. Most of the times they don't get reported, but if they do get reported and there are certain investigations, then the investigating teams, the officers also need to be made aware of. And the ISPs, the internet service providers, when we say they've opened a social media platform, they are equally responsible. Should they be not filtering? Should they be not doing the due diligence which is required to, you know, allow a publication or even a page, maybe like Blue Whale, to be on their site? Is it? It's a huge responsibility as a company. So I think the cyber awareness is something which is very essential for all stakeholders here. It's not just to do with children or parents.
Pranish, you're disagreeing clearly.
ISP should not be in the business of blocking any websites. ISPs are conduits they ideally shouldn't even be able to see what's flowing through their pipes, okay, and they should not be making decisions about what a parent, you know, decisions a parent should be making. So a parent should be deciding what, you know, perhaps his or her child may view or not. Not an ISP.
I will clarify like this point. When we say ISPs, when we say intermediaries, I think that'd be a better word here, because when we say the site operators, if there's a social media platform, for instance, and they are informed that there's an objectionable video there, something which is harmful to the kid, even the law says on actual notice they need to remove it. Child pornography, if you take that issue, isn't that something
that we are
obviously accountable for, and we should be having some due diligence for
no
that?
No debate on that.
Certainly. So when we say in US, for example, or in UK, there are laws which even prohibit malvertising or sites which are deceptive, something which is misleading. A child just types on Google, for instance, or any other search engine. He just types a harmless, he's working on a project and he types chick or a doll, and he comes across lots of content which he's not supposed to see. So there are a lot of websites which are into malvertising, lot of websites which will mislead children into a particular objectionable content, and that should be prohibited.
Okay,
there's
and
no
that's interesting
that.
Because as Anju pointed out, and we've seen there was a case reported in the papers where they're calling the first case of mobile dependency in India, a 9-year-old boy in Haryana who was addicted, and when his parents tried to take him away from all of these mobiles and screens, he would cut himself or bang his head against the wall. What was interesting in that case, as Anju pointed out, is that the parents said they actually encouraged this kid to be at home because they didn't want him to have bad influences outside. Is it safer at home when you're on the net? Because it seems that statistics have shown that cyber crime is increasing at a much faster rate than regular crime.
No, there are a lot of dangers on the internet. Let me explain that there are, from cyber bullying to problems like sexting, problems like harassment, pornography. Then there are problems like online gambling, online gaming, which is dangerous. And now, not only that, you would see that there are also phishing attacks through children. A lot of children even have credit cards of parents. And you would know that when they're online shopping, they're asking for a book or a CD to be delivered at home. They don't know what app they're downloading without a virus check. And God knows it has keyloggers.
All right, let's finish. Why do you disagree? These are children. I can understand you can have an argument if it were an adult. You're saying that you're only as sophisticated, the tool is only as sophisticated as the user, but these are children involved.
Absolutely. But the intermediary doesn't know that whether it's a child or it's an adult, right?
I'd like to say something here. We as parents have to be conscious, in the sense there is a child who is 5 years old. And you know that child cannot have a Facebook account. But the child puts its official age above the limit which is there, and then when you are allowing the child to use Facebook, it's whose responsibility? What he says is, actually, if suppose the messages are checked in between, they are not encrypted, then we cannot have any secrecy that is there. I would not like people to see the messages in between.
What I'm trying to point out is we're missing, well, pardon the pun, but the blue whale in the room, which is that kids are engaging in self-harm, kids are committing suicide. We are in a situation where schools generally, when I went to school, there was no psychological counseling available in school. In my university, multiple people committed suicide, okay, including a good friend, and we did not have any counselors there. Okay, so the kinds of things that we need to be focusing on isn't the big bad internet, because there's the big great internet as well, right? So it's all about how it is used, and we don't want the government to be doing the parents' job. We shouldn't. What we need, on the other hand, is education of teachers, of schools, of parents. One practical example of why I believe this kind of education is necessary is, if in the newspapers you read instances of why people think it's blue whale, they talk about things like self-harm, okay, which is supposedly one of the things that
one of the
tutors
supposed to do.
Yes, what they're supposed to do. Except I know people, my peers, teens, when I was growing up, who engaged in self-harm. Not because of some tutor told them to do so, but because they were, you know, coming from a place where they were disturbed.
Okay, Natasha, let me ask you this.
Slightly different when you are coerced, when you have information available and you are vulnerable and you have a diathesis, which is why it is very important, because like somebody rightly said, the parents themselves are so mesmerized that when it comes to children, they're not able to stop them, you know, they're not able to stop them by the right example, the right mentoring, you know. And so when the child goes in an 8-year or a 10-year child goes to make an account where you're required to be 16 or 18 and puts a false age, the parent is not in a position to stop that. And when it then comes to a family brunch, I don't think it's about the meal or the time spent together. It's about the beautiful picture that you take and that you post online right then and how many likes you get. And I think the self-esteem of the child is getting more and more tarnished because it is dependent on how many likes you are going to get. And if the adequate number of likes do not come through, then the child is forced to withdraw it and post another picture. And it's then running through the family. It's about what car I bought and what holiday I took. And it's about comparisons. And it's about, so I think it's time that we spoke about what is called as internet hygiene. You know, we spoke. I totally agree with you when you say that we need to communicate with the children. We need to have a dialogue like this where we do not take it lightly. Communication is the key. We need to talk to our children and prime them, because to vulnerable mind, this can be very, very dangerous.
Okay, so Natasha, let me play devil's advocate, right? Has anything really changed? Because teenagers are teenagers. Is it just that what they're fighting with their parents over has changed? Today it's the internet. When we were growing up, it was, you were constantly being told, don't watch so much TV. When guests come, you don't put the TV off. Has anything really changed?
In many ways, it hasn't, except that we now have a new variable. Within the family space, within the domestic space, within the home, we have one more variable, which is the smartphone, which is the internet-enabled smartphone, which means that, you know, constantly, you don't even have to go to the desktop, you don't even have to open your laptop. Right. It's right here. You're having a conversation and you can't remember a name, look it up. You know, so it's becoming so much a part of our lifestyle that it is something that we have to look at very carefully. And it's not going to help us to try to simplify something that is multi-layered. Like Pranesh is pointing out constantly, mental health issues is not something that as a culture we pay attention to, you know, and we have a psychologist and a psychiatrist both on the panel here. And, you know, one of the first things you said was children who come to your clinic with addictions, one of the symptoms, you described it as inability to deal with frustration or boredom. Here's this drug. I'm bored, I'm frustrated, I go online. And the minute the internet is turned off or the smartphone is taken away, here's my tantrum.
I think on the name of privacy, we're creating spaces in their lives that are being filled by these apps, these smartphones.
Yeah. Where parents when we take a decision like Khushbu, you know, I totally endorse that. You, as a parent, you parent not with instructions, not with words. You parent with your mind and body. Right. You know, you're a role model. And one of the important things you're going to do when you say no smartphone, no internet, is what do you do in that time? You don't leave that child alone. What happened to, you know, building blocks and Scrabble and Carom and, you know, Sudoku and going out for a walk? And so who's the lazier generation, the parent or the child?
I completely agree on that. So Dr. Sharma, then tell us, so are mental health issues the cause or the effect of excessive reliance on smartphones and in the internet and computers?
I would say it's like a bi-directional relationship exists between online activities and the psychological issues, the mental health issues. Sometimes because of excessive use of technology, the user may develop various type of psychological issues like irritability, anger, and sometimes self-harm also we have seen. When because the child always prefers the virtual world because of whatever the reasons are there in his environment. And whenever we make attempts to take away the virtual world, the first reaction comes of anger, irritability, and sometimes he or she indulges in self-harm also to get back that virtual world scenario. And that is the somewhere the problem comes up. And as all people have pointed out, like there is always a need for communication. There is always a need for increasing the skill in cyber literacy, because the skill has to be enhanced for students. Skill has to be enhanced for teachers, parents, because until and unless all, or as well as the other educator in the society, if all of them work together, I think definitely we can bring a change in the...
Okay, let's get some audience reactions. Does anyone want to pitch in? Because this obviously affects us all. Go ahead.
I have a question to Sir Pranay sir. 50% of the parents don't know what Mozilla Firefox is. So what about the parents who don't know what's a child up to?
Knowing technology isn't what parenting is about. Trust and having conversations with your child is what parenting is about. So you don't need to know anything about a smartphone or about apps or anything to be able to have discussions with your child about what is safe, what isn't safe. And it's not only parents that I'd like to push this on. I'd say it's also the job of schools, of counselors. I believe all of us ought to join in this and make sure that kids are safe. What I'm trying to point out as the easy solution, which is what there's a PIL in the Supreme Court right now. The Kerala Chief Minister has written to the central government about banning the Blue Whale Challenge, and the central government has written to multiple intermediaries about ban this thing. Except this thing doesn't exist. So it's not a movie that can be banned. It's not an app that can be banned. Right. It's not a website.
Are we making it a scapegoat and not actually addressing the situation at hand or the problem at hand? Go ahead, ma'am.
Actually, I agree too, sir. I am a parent. I have three daughters. Whole day is busy. But I know I have to be with my daughters and in this world. So I myself take out some time. I be with them on Facebook. I show them videos. I know what they should know. That much we do. Over. I don't know what is Firefox. I'm hearing your first time. But what is the thing is, awesome. I know my kids should be with the world, so I do that much for them.
Okay, so if you can't beat them, join them. At least do that. If you can't be like Khushbu and get off, you wanted to react now.
I totally agree with Sir Pranesh. It is the mental hygiene or the mental health which is the issue and not the internet. Because I'm a teacher myself, we as teachers, we as parents, I'm a parent too, we need to give quality time to our children rather than blaming, you know. I'm really impressed by that ma'am who just quit, you know. It will be a nightmare for me if I quit the WhatsApp group of my class, of, you know, that 6A class 6A group. Stop. It's going to be really difficult, but then I minimize the use of it. It is actually, you know, it's the parents' responsibility and nobody else's, I believe.
I think the parent responsibility, parents have to learn from judgmental to become non-judgmental about activities. True. Until unless you become non-judgmental, child will not come. Child will not.
Okay, we have a student here. Clearly you're in uniform and you want to speak. Let me ask you, how would you like this problem to be looked at? Would you prefer that your parents allow you complete freedom? Should they like have these software and where they can spy on what you're doing or at least know what you're doing?
See, basically it's depends on person to person what they are doing. But as we talk of the parent, there should be something which restrict the child what they're doing. So they should know what their child is doing on the phone or whatever, like on the social media and all those things. And as if I think, it's also the peer pressure that is going on these days. As a student, I would say that there is a new trend, or it's like a competition nowadays. That like last year there was the game Pokemon Go. It was like people went crazy for it. It was like a competition, like how many Pokemons you got, oh I got this Pokemon, and this went on. So there's not a complete full stop to this. So
how much time are you allowed?
So I'm not allowed after 10 o'clock, that's it. Whatever you do it before 10 o'clock.
And you're okay with that?
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
And your friends, when they're on, you say it's peer pressure. What about your friends? If they're on, what do you do?
So they are on, it's upon them what to do. I can't help them. I have to see on myself what I'm doing. So that's what I say, it depends on person to person.
Okay, some reactions there, but maybe one solution is that all parents together unite around one certain rule or something. Let's say if everybody says no access post 10, it might be helpful because then you don't have peer pressure for these
kids. Yeah, I think I come here as a parent. Many times what happens, I'm using my mobile and my daughter says, oh, Papa, why? What is it? It is dinner time. You should not be using it. I say, no, okay, I think I'm sorry. We are the role models as parents. And if we get into all such things, it becomes difficult for on our part to stop our children. This is more, and I think we need to build greater trust. and show some ways in which we can have some mutuality.
Okay. So nothing changes. People have been having babies for decades and centuries. Right. Talk to your children. That is the only solution.
We have been, told by our parents and our grandparents that these days we do not really respect them as they used to respect their parents and grandparents. So I would like to ask all the people sitting here that do you really think internet is behind it?
I come from a state called Jammu and Kashmir. Last year, the internet was banned for 6 months and people survived. So putting all the blame on internet, the people started like they did in earlier times.
Yeah.
So that's all.
They
I
met
think.
Each other. Okay. They stepped out of their
they
home.
Stepped
yeah.
They stepped
the
out.
Yeah.
Out.
They
stepped out.
Pass it on. Pass it on.
I would like to say, rather than the age, it's the game of the brain. It's not only the toddlers, it's not only the teenagers, the young adults, but also our parents. It's me who sometimes goes up to my mother and I'm like, Mom, please, let's just leave your phone for some time and focus on me, because I'm right here. She works 24/7. She does not sleep. I have not seen her in a peaceful sleep since ages. So that's the problem. It's not just the children.
So parents are setting the example.
One thing which I would say, that in the schools, the environment should be such that children should be able to approach the authorities. Yes. It is like that at times, children, suppose let's say child has told you something, and if we leak it out, the confidence is not there, children will not come to you. In my case, I've handled a girl who had become addicted to drinking in class 12. And she had developed withdrawal symptoms, and when she came to me and discussed, she said, Ma'am, I really don't want my parents to know. If my parents come to know, you know that I belong to XYZ family, my father will murder me. And I had challenged how to handle that girl. Our counselor spoke to that girl daily for 1 hour in the night time when she developed the desire to have that. For we had long counseling sessions with her without letting the parents know, and the child was able to come out of it. I had taken the risk.
Okay, I want to get quick closing arguments because we're out of time. Pushpu, how does one raise a confident screenager today?
I think we have forgotten what the family values are. In a room, you have a family of five on a sofa, and all five of them will be looking into their phones because they're not striking a conversation. Also, what is important is, we should get rid of this nuclear family system and make sure that you have an elderly person, grandparents at home, because they have a huge influence on the children of today. My mother-in-law, my mother, everyone stays with me. So it helps so much to have a joint family system. And I think, parents, both the parents today, the situations are such where both the parents need to work, and they actually don't try to understand what the child wants. So I think it's very important for parents to understand a child, not force them, rather tell them what is right and what is wrong lovingly. And the most important thing is gain their confidence. Parents can be approachable. Parents will understand them because parents love them unconditionally, and they will not be judgmental. They'll try to find a solution to a problem. So that
all
is
right.
The kind of confidence which
but
your parents
a joint
need to
family may not
build
be a solution,
with a child.
Not be
and
something that everybody wants to do. And there are cultures in the world who are managing without that. Karishma, quick closing argument.
Yeah, I just want to say the internet is also like a mirror in one sense. So whatever exaggerated social issues we face, the treatment of women, the way we look at children, our sense of how we exploit or how we want self-validation, of course it's going to be there in the virtual world. We have to fix ourselves. And I just want to say one thing. My children, I wake up to the smell of muffins baking because they're on YouTube and they're looking up recipes all the time. They know about the French Revolution and the American Revolution, and they know about slavery, and they know so much. And I myself know so much because of the internet. It's a big, vast, open space. It's meant for freedom. It's meant for discovery, exploration, coming together and building things. Yes, there are negatives. Yes, there are dangers. But when I walk out of this door, I face the same thing.
Dr. Sharma, respond. It's hugely, there are huge advantages. Where does one draw the line then?
I think I would advocate have a good lifestyle and enjoy the technology. So
if for every cyber bully out there, there are 10 support forums that allow weird kids to feel that they actually belong. So, and along with that, I'd like to advocate for media literacy, teaching kids about things like fake news and teaching journalists about things like fake news so that they don't hype. You've been hearing about Blue Whale Challenge all over television. It doesn't even exist. Yet, you've been convinced that it's a real thing. Thankfully, here I'm hoping debunk that.
All right, last closing argument to you.
So, please look at it as a boon. It's a beautiful space, but it's also very important to understand that there is enough evidence that is emerging to show that a lot of facets of personality can be groomed, can be cultivated much better offline in experimenting with real life. So please do not deny yourself the opportunity to have trysts and experiments with real life. Go out and make friends. Develop your intrapsychic apparatus, your structure, your resilience. I think the frustration tolerance is something that we need to work upon. It's important that our kids have a sound, stable self-esteem and they can go and experiment with the real world, because that's where the challenges will lie. And it will not be those 2,000 friends that you have on Facebook that will come handy. Well, it will be the real life situation.
Closing arguments, Natasha, you have to build a self-esteem. For centuries, that's what teenagers
absolutely
fight with.
And this conversation where we keep going back to the fact that you have to allow them access to, you know, these serials, these apps, these devices, because their peers are using it, and peer pressure means so much to teenagers. What we are not looking at is how adults are succumbing to peer pressure. Yeah, I need to be seen. I have a fear of missing out. I am scared to exit a WhatsApp group because what will people say? Well, I really need to look at the peer pressure that I'm succumbing to. You're going to have a really hard time leaving that WhatsApp group, but you're going to survive it. It's going to be just fine. They'll find another way of getting in touch with you.
Because it all ends with us in the end. There is that log off button. You can turn it off. The question is, will you turn it off? We're completely out of time. Join us again next week on We the People, where we can raise issues that matter. It's important to speak up, but it's also important to listen. Bye-bye. Good night. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.